It's great to be back with you again. I know you've had some interesting sermons preached to you, and I hope mine's just as interesting. I want to welcome you all to Faith Church. And who are we? Well, our mission is to express God's love to all, invite others to know Jesus, and make faithful disciples. Let us enter into God's gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise. To welcome you all to the Faith Kids portion of our sermon. The video this week is the triumphant entry.
The story of Easter, the triumphal entry. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love and healed people from their sickness. He did many miracles like calming storms and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
At this time, the Jewish people were celebrating a festival called Passover that had been celebrated since the time of Moses when God brought his people out of Egypt. So Jesus was going to Jerusalem to celebrate. Jesus and his disciples stopped in a town.
You coming?
And Jesus told two of his disciples to go on ahead of them.
Okay.
He told them to go into a village and that they would see a young donkey that no one had ever ridden.
Rock!
He told them to untie it and bring it to him. If anyone asks, what are you doing? He told them to just say, "The Lord needs it, and we'll return it soon."
Okay, go ahead.
So the disciples did what Jesus said and brought him the donkey. A long time ago, before Jesus was even born, God had said that the Savior, the King of Israel, would come to Israel in this way. And now Jesus was doing just as God had said. The news that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem swept through the city. Many heard about all the amazing things he had done, so they cut palm branches and ran to see him.
Huh?
The Pharisees and religious rulers realized that there was nothing they could do, for everyone was going to see Jesus. Jesus rode into the city of Jerusalem, and the crowd spread their coats on the road ahead of him. His followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. The Pharisees were upset.
Hey, Jesus!
And they told Jesus to stop the people from saying things like that. But Jesus said, if they keep quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers. So the people kept on singing, "Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in highest heaven." The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered, asking, "Who is this?" And the crowds replied, "It's Jesus." And Jesus rode the donkey through the street of Jerusalem to the temple in a triumphal entry, just as God said he would many years before.
Wasn't that a wonderful lesson for faith kids? It's a good lesson for us too to remember. Now let's prepare our hearts for sermon with song, prayer, scripture, and word of God for us today.
Oh,
Please pray with me. Past, present, and future God, Creator, Sustainer, Redeemer, help us to remember home and to hope in a promised land, that we might know you, Alpha and Omega, 3 in 1. We bring to you today the joys and concerns of our hearts. We give you thanks for all the gifts you have given us. We pray for those who are in need of healing and wholeness. And as we lift up one another, as we go through the season of uncertainty in our lives, God, we know deep within our hearts that by the power of your loving presence, you are able to accomplish and abundantly far more than we can ask or even imagine. These are your words, O God. Humble us to speak their weight. Strengthen us to heal the truth. Unbind us to live the call. Through the power of your Holy Spirit and for the sake of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our scripture today is Matthew 22, verses 1 through 13. Now, I'm not going to read it to you because I've embedded it in the sermon. It's about the wedding feast. You know, do you ever get an invitation and say, what's this for? And, you know, my mother-in-law used to hold it up to the light. You know, she wouldn't open it. She'd just hold it up to the light. You know, I'd say, well, why don't you open it? And then we can see who it's from. One cold winter night in Glen Rock, Pat and I were sitting there watching TV. And our daughter Amy called. She said, I got an invitation to an inaugural ball, but I didn't vote for that person. Should I go? Our immediate response was, of course you should go. How many people get such an invitation in their entire lifetime? I have to tell you, she went and had a great time. It's like getting an invitation to the wedding from the Queen of England. You know, Jesus loved weddings. His first miracle was at a wedding. On one occasion, he referred to himself as a bridegroom. So you shouldn't be surprised that there are several of his parables that feature a wedding. The kingdom of heaven is like a king, he said, who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come. But they did something quite extraordinary. They refused the invitation. This was most unusual to refuse the king's invitation. Nevertheless, there were those who refused to come. When the king sent more servants and said, tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. Again, his invitation was spurned. Some of those who received the invitation went back to their field or back to their business. The rest seized the king's servants, mistreated them, and eventually killed them. The king was enraged, as you might imagine. He sent his army and destroyed those who were guilty of those crimes and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to banquet anyone you find. So the servants went out into the streets, gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. The parable sounds very much like the parable about a landowner who rented his vineyard to come to some rebellious tenants, doesn't it? But the story takes a strange twist. The wedding did go on with those who chose to come. However, when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed that one man was not wearing wedding clothes. He asked, how do you get in here without wedding clothes, friend? The man was speechless. He didn't know what to say. He wasn't wearing the right clothes. Everyone else wore tuxes and evening clothes, and he was in jeans and a tattered t-shirt. Does wearing the right clothes matter? Some of you will remember when David Brinkley was one of America's favorite newscasters. In his book, David Brinkley, a Memoir, he tells about coming to work for NBC in the late 1940s. At that time, NBC was considered itself the elegant network. The rule was that after 6 p.m., radio newscasters were required to read the news wearing tuxedos. Can you imagine that? Their radio audience couldn't see the newscasters, but the NBC management believed their attitude and presentation skills improved dramatically when they were properly attired. Let's face it, times are changing, particularly when it comes to apparel. The whole world seems to be moving forward toward casual Friday all week long. Executives, particularly in relatively high new high-tech companies, are dressing more casually. Doctors are dressing more casually. Teachers are dressing more casually. Yeah, even pastors dress more casually. As you can see, I have a polo shirt on. Attend a worship service in some of the fastest growing churches in our country, and you're going to see the pastor attired in jeans or a t-shirt. But let me ask you a question. Does it make any difference how the person is that's presenting the message? Jesus tells a parable about a wedding guest who was not appropriately attired. This was not because he couldn't afford wedding clothes. It was a custom in Jesus' time for the host to provide free garments for all the guests. The man knew better than to be dressed as he was. But eventually he didn't care. The king didn't cut him any slack. He said to his attendants, "Bind him hand and foot. Throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen." Now this is kind of a shocking test for me and for many people. For you see, it's not about the clothes at all. The text implies that there are certain qualifications for those who follow Jesus. This text implies that God cares about how his children live. Many people today have heard the message of grace. Jesus loves me. Jesus accepts me just as I am. Whoopee! I'm saved! I'm headed for the promised land. But wait a minute. That's only part of the gospel message. You know, God loves serial killers and child molesters. God loves ruthless and arrogant businessmen. God loves manipulative mothers that damage their children's emotions for life. But the point is, God's love is that he wants them to change. He hates what they're doing and the effects it has on everyone and on themselves too. God cannot allow this sort of behavior and that sort of person, if they don't change, to remain forever in the party he's throwing for his son. The point of the story, according to Bishop Wright, is that God's kingdom is a kingdom where love, justice, and truth, and mercy, and holiness reign unhindered. There are clothes that you need to wear for the wedding. And if you refuse to put them on, you're saying you don't want to stay at the party. You may think those are hard words, but they are very much a part of the gospel. God loves us as we are, but God expects us to clothe ourselves with the character of Jesus Christ. That's one reason we come to worship, to get to know Christ so that we may be more like him. We all want God. We all want to know him and see him. But do we want to be like Jesus? That's the ultimate question. Do we really want his willingness to forgive others? Do we really want his compassion, his concern for the least and the lost? We want God, yet are we willing to let him change us into the image of his son? God wants us at that wedding feast, but he wants us to put on the proper wedding garments. He wants us to put on Christ. Lee Strobel, in his book, The Case for Faith, tells about the man that did it in a dramatic fashion. His name is William Neal Moore. In 1975, Moore committed a heinous crime. He broke into an old man's house, robbed him, took his life savings, and shot him to death. Well, Moore was caught, convicted, and sentenced to die. While in prison, William Moore gave his life to Christ. Now, I know what you're thinking. Another death row conversion, a matter of convenience when you're about to meet your maker. But it wasn't like that for William Moore. Immediately, he was a changed man. He began counseling other prisoners and leading Bible studies. He converted so many prisoners in his cell block that it became known as the most peaceful, safest area in the whole prison. He contacted his victim's family and was granted their forgiveness. After 16 years on death row, the state of Georgia voted to release William Moore. Never had they taken a guilty person off of death row and set him free. But William Moore was a great witness and influence in prison, convinced that the state officials that he was truly a new man. You know, such things happen to people who yield their lives to Christ. The difficult thing for you and for me is to see that God wants to make dramatic changes in our lives. We think we're pretty good people, but God wants us to be so much better. A man was at a party without proper clothes. Could that have been you? Could it have been me? We've accepted God's grace, but have we sought to yield our lives to His direction? Have we sought to put on Christ? I like the way author Marianne Williamson puts it. She compares us to house. She writes, "You think God is going to come into your house, look around and see that you need a new floor or better furniture, and then everything needs a little cleaning. Then you look out the window one day and see there's a wrecking ball outside. It turns out that God actually thinks the whole foundation is shot and you're going to have to start from scratch." Let me ask you, friend, is it time you checked your foundation? Is it time you got serious about your faith? Is it time you accept the free garment that Christ wants to give us so that you can enjoy the wedding party? Amen. And now, let us meditate on today's sermon during this song. As we leave this shared space today, let us make a commitment to stay connected with each other. Let us dedicate our offerings to the mission that God has given us at Faith Church, and let us enter into this new week with God's blessings. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the day and for the goodness and love that you have shown us in Christ, and pray your blessings upon these gifts. May they build your love in the world that we honor in your name. For the benediction, we ask you to keep us in love, challenge us in faith, and sustain us with grace this day and always. And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. And now, Faith Church, remember, stay connected. And let's get ready to welcome Pastor Rob back. Now may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.